Hi, I'm Pat Franzino from New York City, and this is the Rosie O'Donnell Show. On today's show, the Young and the Restless's Shemar Moore, Broadway's You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, Stockard Channing, and Jeanette's visit to Albania. Hit it, John!
I'll be right with you, Pat. Hi, buddy.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Can you turn and look out in the camera so everyone can see you? What's your name?
AJ.
How old are you?
5.
5 years old? Oh, my goodness. Have you ever been to a TV show before?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, which one?
That one.
Yeah. You're on that one, and look, you're on that one, too. Can you believe it?
Yeah.
You want to see another one? You're on right there, buddy. Right here. Look, that's you. Wave. See? There you are. Can I tell you something?
What?
You are a cutie patootie. You are. Yeah. Are you going to go to any of the New York Liberty games?
Yeah, 3 days.
3 days you're going?
You know who Spoon is?
Yes, Teresa Witherspoon and Sophia Weatherspoon. They're great, aren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're only going to go to 3 games?
Yeah.
Is you here with your mommy or your daddy?
I'm here with my mommy.
You're here with your mommy? Well, tell your mommy that we're going to give you tickets to all the games. AJ, come here. Can you give me a kiss right there? Can I give you a kiss right there? Goodbye, sweetie pie. Pat, how cute is he?
He's adorable.
Standing in the middle of the aisle going like this to me. How are you, Pat?
I'm fine, thank you.
Lovely
how are
to
you?
Meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Where are you from?
New York City.
New York City.
Yes.
And what do you do for a living?
Well, I'm retired, actually. I retired about a year and a half ago.
From?
I was 18 years in the commodities business. I worked with the same boss, 18 years. And I packed it in about a year and a half ago.
Just because you thought it was time for a change?
Yep.
Time for a little relaxation?
Just because I could, yeah.
Because you could. Yeah. Well, good for you. More
Thank
people
you.
Would like that
yeah.
option in their life,
fun.
I'm sure.
It's been fun.
You're here because of a charity.
Yes, my husband attended the Jim Kelly benefit back in, I think it was January, Hunter's Hope Charity.
Right.
And he bid on the Rosie O'Donnell basket, and here I am.
There you go.
Yeah.
Way to go, Pat. That's a wonderful, wonderful cause.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
It is, and so very sad that I believe it's Krebs disease, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it is.
The name
yeah.
of it. And he is a son who's very, very ill, and he's done so much to bring awareness. And I thank you and your husband both for bidding on that for
You're
a worthwhile
very welcome.
Cause.
Thank you.
Thank you. And would the 4 people with those shirts please come down here quickly? Look at this as something new. Quickly, hello, quick. Move you over here. Now, who made these shirts?
My mom and I helped.
You are all very crafty.
Yeah, thank
Is
you.
This mom and grandma and kids?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. What can I get you for making those shirts?
Jackets.
No. They're totally prepared for what they want. There's no longer an element of surprise on this show. It used to be, I'm going to give you a jacket and then shock horror, you know? Yes. Now it's like, we'd like the jacket. I'll give you all the jackets, Grandma, because you know what?
Thank you, Rosie.
These are adorable and it looks like a curtain, and
yes.
who would have thought?
Yes.
For the crafty family named?
The Beckmans and May Shirko.
The Beckmans and May Shirko. Thanks for being here. Now go back to your seat.
You.
Say hello to John McPhee and the McPhee LP.
Excellent. How's it going?
Good to see you. Got a lot
and
to
you.
Talk about today.
Yeah,
lots
true.
To talk about.
That's true.
Lots of great guests are here. Shemar Moore is going to be here.
Yep.
Stockard Channing.
Yep.
Cast of You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown.
Great show.
And I got a call from Robert De Niro, Julia Armand, and Susan Sarandon, who are all committee members of the Film Aid Committee. And it's a great idea what they're doing. They're going to provide TVs and VCRs for all of the refugees and camps in Kosovo because, frankly, they have nothing to do all day. There's like three soccer balls and different toy companies have sent stuff. I think, you know, the toy companies that always do business with us have sent over 14,000 toys.
Wow.
Hasbro and the Koosh Ball people. And it's not, you know, it's the stuff that they need truly, money in every way, but they also need something during those 24 hours to think of other than the horror that they have just survived.
Right.
And over to Albania herself on her week's vacation from the show. So she wanted to talk to us about that. Stouffer's Lean Cuisine. Nothing comes better than home or something like that.
Closer to home.
Everyone's getting a T-shirt and everyone's getting a hearty portion meal because they are our Chubb Club sponsors and they've done such a fabulous thing and they'll be our sponsors through the millennium. Over the summer, do not quit. Still work out.
That's right.
Like I've been doing. And I'm a tremendous failure, and I'm not embarrassed to admit it.
Well.
Ever since we started featuring different desks on this show, we got thousands and thousands of letters and emails from viewers with ideas of what they think is the perfect desk. The ideas for today's desk came from a group of Eagle Scouts in Florida who sent us a tape that cracked me up, made me laugh so much, I said, get those boys on my show. Take a look at the tape that they sent me.
You do us well. You're so great. We're so glad you're coming to our state. Listen here.
Listen now.
We think everything's coming up, Rosie. I can sing. I can dance. Rosie has the power to entrance. We just made Eagle Scout. We would love to meet you, Miss O'Donnell.
We could build you a desk. It would be more unique than the rest.
We will try very hard. Please don't turn us away, Miss O'Donnell.
We are from Tampa Bay, and we made up this song just to say,
Eagle Scouts love you best. Because everything's coming up, Rosie, for you and for me.
Stop. Rosie time.
Not only a desk, but a song and dance number with choreography? How could I say no? Please welcome Eagle Scouts Crawford, Andy, and Eric. Now, guys, how are you?
Great.
Great. We're doing so good.
Explain the desk that you made for us today.
Well, we took us a week to put it together.
Sorry.
But
yeah?
We worked really hard on it.
Yeah, now you incorporated a lot of Eagle Scout knowledge in this desk.
Yeah, lashings is what they're called. The rope holding all the logs together is called lashings. There are several different types in there. We held it together with lashings.
Yeah. Yeah. What about the slingshot is for my Koosh balls?
Yes.
That I can launch them from there?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to try one for you boys. See how this goes.
Yep. No.
Rosie,
you pull it back.
It's a catapult.
The whole thing?
Catapult.
Oh, you see, I was never an Eagle Scout. this is going to be good. Careful, Kendra, in the front row. Wait, let me try one more time. Let me try one more time here. Yeah! It's good if there are very short people around and go right to them, you know? Now, how long have you guys been in the Boy Scouts, Eagle Scouts?
Mostly 9, 10 years.
Almost
9, 10 years.
Yeah.
Who's the most famous Eagle Scout around?
Most famous Eagle Scout.
Like, well, somebody who's been through that is now a grown-up?
Yeah, Steven Spielberg.
Yeah. Steven Spielberg, yeah. Definitely.
He's quite the bomb.
He is. He's really good, huh?
Yeah.
He was an Eagle Scout. It's a great organization, I think. What are the main values of the Eagle Scouts?
Trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous,
a lot
kind,
of
obedient,
honor.
Cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. That's the Scout law.
Wow, there you go. Do you know that motto?
Yes.
Let me hear you say it as quick as he did.
Trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent.
Those are good values for everyone, Franklin. They're all Eagle Scouts. Now, I have been awarded the opportunity from the Eagle Scout program to tell you that by making this desk, you have earned 3 badges. Are you aware of this?
Yes.
Yes, you've earned Pioneering Merit Badge, the Theater Merit Badge for that wonderful performance, and the Cinematography Merit Badge for that video that you made. So I'm going to come around here and give these to you right now. There you go.
Thank you.
There you go. There you go. And then we called the Eagle Scouts and we asked if we could make up a badge, and they said, whatever. And so we made you the Rosie O'Donnell Show badge. There you go, to put on your costume. Right there, your uniform.
Wow. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
This is so cool.
Now, you're Andy, right?
Yeah.
I've received many phone calls from the people in Tampa and many letters saying that your goal in life is to sing with me on this show.
Yeah.
Your dream is about to come true, Andrew. Come over here. What song would you like to do?
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata. Interesting choice, but fine. Now, Andy and I, with a very hoarse voice, will sing. You start, dude.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Right from the beginning, that's good.
Hakuna Matata.
Uh-huh.
Ain't no passing craze. It means no worries for the rest of your day. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata. Ain't no passing grace. It means no worries.
Wow!
For the rest of your days. It's a problem free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
Malcolm Winters on Young and the Restless. Our first guest sizzles, and ladies, guess what? He may soon be available because he thinks his brother slept with his wife, Olivia. Not good. Take a look.
I mean, you feel like because I'm your brother that I crossed the line.
Okay, just save it. Save it. You're only digging yourself in deeper. You make me sick. Why don't you just do as I ask and get out of my face?
What are you talking about? I make you sick. Malcolm, what are you
doing?
Devin,
what is wrong with you? Are you dense? One last time, get the hell up out of my studio. Lord help me, you're gonna be carried out of here.
And I don't blame him. And you know what she says? She says, oh no, I was just taking a nap in the bed. Please welcome back to the show, the cutie patootie, Shemar Moore.
I'm very well, Rosie.
So good to see you.
Oh, I'm jazzed. I'm in New York City hanging with my girl, Rosie.
Yeah, and you're always looking fabulous, I might add.
Well, right back at you, girl.
Oh, thank you, Shemar.
A little tit for tat. That's
now,
how
listen,
we do it.
I gave you a little hug there. I felt the little muscles in the chest, that little G.I. Joe thing going on there.
I'll show you the receipts later.
Really? Yeah. Do you work out a lot?
You know, yeah, I do. Just, I was an athlete all my life, so...
Right.
it's kind of been a part of my life, running and taking care, you know, jogging, lifting weights, doing the whole thing. But now that I'm in the land of television, and, you know, they say camera adds weight and does this and that.
Yeah.
More than anything, it makes me feel good. But yeah. I do a lot of boxing and running and,
the
whole thing. You know what I like is this Chubb Club thing you got going.
You like that?
I like it a lot. And, yeah. I applaud it because I was definitely, I could have been a member back in the day.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. I'm gonna get it started right now.
What do you got?
I was a chunky monkey.
You were?
I had junk in the trunk.
Let me see. Oh, this would inspire so many people.
I was a big boy. There you go. Huh?
Oh, but that's just baby fat, Shemar.
No.
Look at that. You're just a cutie little chubby baby.
No. Let me tell you the story behind this. But I used to live out of the country when I was a kid. And I lived a lot of places, but when I lived in Denmark right after I was born. I was born in Oakland, born in California, we left the country. And when I was in Denmark, it's a Danish-speaking country. Now, the Danes are known for being very free with their nudity and sexuality and the whole thing, so everybody runs around butt naked.
Ooh.
So here I am, this chunky little kid, big old lopsided afro, wearing Danish clogs, and my mother would stick me in a high chair to feed me. And then when I was done eating, I'd put my hands up and I'd say, more, which means, Mom, come get me, I'm done, basically.
Right.
But then she said I looked like a little Buddha belly because my belly would hang over the, you know, the tabletop that the kids put the food on?
Oh, really?
My belly would hang over and lay on the tabletop.
Oh.
And I'd be sitting there going, more.
And she'd say,
oh, my little Buddha belly. So that was really cute then, but she still calls me that to this day.
She does. Mm-hmm. But when you were in school, were you heavy then? Or when you got to be like in kindergarten, first grade, you weren't chubby?
I went up and down.
Did.
I was chubby for probably the first 5 years, then I got skinny, and then in high school, like freshman year, I got that chubby, you know, cutesy cheeks, grandma wants to pinch your cheeks kind of thing. And then I got thin again, and then when I got into college, playing sports and stuff, there's a fine line for me because I gain weight very easily. People don't think I do. Yeah, that's why I exercise so much, is I can gain 10 pounds in a week.
Well, you're right what you said about TV adding weight because, you know, I'm only 120.
Yeah.
And it's just on camera that I look, you know, 200. Anyway, I want to say, Shemar, is anyone ever going to forget you presenting the Emmy Award to Susan Lucci? It was the greatest thing. It was.
It really was the greatest thing.
Now, when you said, I was watching you said the streak, I didn't even hear the rest. I was just up because I knew it had to be her. Did you plan on saying that?
As soon as you heard streak, you knew?
You said the streak, and I went, you know, I did.
You know, no, I was backstage. More than anything, I was just nervous about, you know, you go out there in front of millions of people, you don't want to flub the lines, and it's a big category. And I had no idea that I was presenting that category.
Right.
I had no clue until I got, you know, you have rehearsal
a
few hours before the actual event. And I got there, and Dick Clark gave me the package, and I opened it up, and it said Outstanding Lead Actress. And I was like, get out of here. I was like, wow. I mean, you know, I would never tell Susan this, but her first nomination came when I was 10 years old.
Yep.
So who would have, and you look great, Susan. You girl?
No, she does.
No, she does. She looks fabulous. But it's just amazing. Who would have thunk that 19 years later, I would have been the guy? So backstage, I didn't want to flub the lines. I had no idea if she was going to win or anything. And we had two people from our show nominated. So it was kind of a tough thing. It's like, you want people from your show to win, but wouldn't it be great if Susan Lucci won?
Because
I'd get to say it.
Exactly.
And I got out there, and I said my spiel. And when I opened the envelope and turned over the card, you just don't expect to see Susan Lucci.
It's been 19 years.
Right. I mean, I was like, what's the difference between now and last year or Sweet 16 or whatever? And when I saw her name, I won't lie, in my head I went, get the bleep out of here.
Yeah.
And in my head, just for that split second. But then once I realized, I said, you know what? We're about to have a party in here. And I went, the streak is over, Susan Lucci.
And we have just a clip because I loved it so much and I want to see it again.
It
so look, this is you.
And the outstanding diva is... The streak is over, Susan Lucci!
It still makes me a little perplexed. And you know, I was sitting right next to her.
No, I saw you. They went right to when she walked away. You were standing there just as proud as you could be because you know Rosie loves her, all my children.
Exactly, you know? But I will tell you this. I've started watching The Young and Restless.
That's right.
Probably
because I bought you the last time I was on the show. I came here the last time I was on the show, I brought her a sweatshirt, brought her a t-shirt, brought you something for your kids, brought you a mug, and you were like, yeah, you're still not Tom Cruise, beat it.
No. Say, you might give my Tommy a run for his money. I can tell you that right now, Shemar Moore.
I'm the brown sugar version of Tom Cruise.
Yes, you are! And everyone needs a little sweetening, I can tell you that. But here's the thing. I started taping it. And at night, I'm watching it. Because, you know, the reason really I objected to your show for so many years is because you stole Cliff Warner
Jack,
from us.
Peter.
Exactly. Yeah. Cliff Warner. Okay, I know on your show he's
Cliff.
Jack.
Cliff.
Obviously, he's going to wake up from the amnesia one day on your show and say, oh, my God, I'm actually Cliff Warner. Where's Nina? I have to get back to Pine Valley. You know, that's what I'm hoping will happen. But it is a very, very, very good show, and it constantly wins so many awards. And you, my dear, are a cutie patootie. I thank you very much for being here. Young and the Restless, watch it. Check your local listings. Very good to see you. We'll be right back after this break. Don't go away. Still ahead from Broadway's Lion in Winter, Stockard Channing. Comedy producers, my friend and a Choke Club member, Jeanette Barber, took a leave of absence. She went to Albania as a volunteer with the relief organization AmeriCares to visit the refugee camps there. Today she'll tell you what that experience was all about. And Jeanette, I've known you for 20 years. What made you get involved? You haven't done a lot of volunteerism, not as an insult, but
right. No,
I was just curious.
Actually, I don't remember ever volunteering for anything. I can't say that I didn't, but I don't recall it.
Right.
And I don't know, which is, I knew you would ask this, I don't really know why I wanted to go, but ever since it started in, you know, this whole war situation, every night I would go home and I would be glued to the TV, and to see thousands and thousands of people every night walking across the border, and they were all crying.
Right.
Did you see that? They would just sit there and wipe their tears. And knowing that what it was about, this particular issue, for some reason for me, ethnic cleansing, it's hard for me to even say that phrase because it disturbs me so much, that you saw thousands of people whose lives, everything they worked for, everything in their life is gone and destroyed just because of who they were born at. It would be if they asked all the Irish. They threw all the Irish out of New York. You lose your homes, you lose everything. You lose the lives of people you loved.
Right.
And
it moved you so much to do something. Right.
And I never had done anything like this before.
Now, did you find it overwhelmingly depressing or sad?
It was very sad, but it wasn't depressing. I found it more uplifting than depressing, because when you go to these camps, the people are unbelievable. They haven't lost their manners. They're totally gracious. They would say hello. At times, if I would get upset, people would come to comfort me, and I would think, you know, I don't even have a problem.
Right.
And they were there.
Well, now your boyfriend Barry went with you, and he had a handheld video camera.
I didn't want to forget any of this.
Right.
Because I think it's, to me, it's the most important thing that I've ever done. So I wanted to make sure that,
yourself, you had it documented.
Yeah, I wanted to know everything that that happened, and I don't want to forget it, and I don't want to go back to being the sort of person that never does do anything.
Now, we have a videotape, and the audio is not very good because it was just Jeanette's boyfriend Barry with a handheld camera. But this is when you tried to give away toys.
The kids. I've never been one that, a big children fan. I didn't really understand. And the kids there were what amazed me the most. They were, they would just crowd around you. They would love you. We brought some toys to try to give them. And you can see at first, it's really encouraging because they're really happy, but there's never enough toys. And they get a little overexcited, as you'll see.
That's it, no. And that's the teacher there telling them no more because the children are becoming unruly in the minds of the teacher.
Right. That's one of the wonderful things is that the adults are so aware of their kids.
Give out the candy, yeah.
That's Barry. He's not hitting them. They want their kids to have manners.
Right.
So I can't give them to my kids.
Now, the man who had that water bottle was one of the teachers or the parents, and the thing that, you know, has so impressed you, as you told me, is that the parents who, in the midst of this chaos,
really tell the children about manners and politeness and kindness.
And they have schools, even when they have no paper, when they have absolutely nothing to do, they are doing, that's why that thing that you talked about in the first segment, the film aid, is such a wonderful thing. These people have nothing to do, and the kids need some structure. And they're, everyone that I went with at AmeriCare seemed to have the same experiences, that you would go in and sometimes there would be a certain kid that would stand out, and I met this one little girl.
Right here.
Yeah. I'm too flustered. I can't remember where to hold things.
And what was her name, Jeanette?
I can't pronounce it, but it was close to Nastinisa. You know what it is? I called her sweetness. You know what I mean?
Right.
Language didn't matter.
Why did she stand out to you?
I don't know. She would come and she would just like hang on my, not hang, but she would hug me and she would look at me, and when I was upset, she tried to make me feel better.
Right.
She wanted me to send her a picture. We went back the next day with a Polaroid because I was afraid to mail her something because I didn't want her to not get it.
So you went back to the camp the next day searching for her because you now had a Polaroid camera.
Yes, I didn't have it the day before, and I was afraid if I just took a snapshot, I couldn't sleep that night. I kept thinking she might not get it.
So
we found tent 12 where she said she lived, but nobody there knew who she was. So we started searching in this camp of 4,000 people to see if we could find her.
And people kept helping you, trying to explain where the different tents were?
And then we discovered that there was two tent 12s.
We're going to tent 12 to find our friend.
Is she here?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi.
We said we'd come back.
Hello. How are you?
Hello. Just for you.
I wanted to give her my white hat.
Where is it?
It's in that bag.
Oh, it's in
the cup.
This is our adopted family.
Bye. Yes. Mm-hmm. We love someone. Bye.
And I know you're trying hard not to cry, Jeanette. And I've known you for 20 years. I've never seen you cry. And since you've come back, I've seen you cry many times. And I think, you know, the tears are what soothes your soul. So.
Well, it is a good thing in a way, because it was sad there, and you see their sadness, and to do the tiniest thing to distract them for, if I could distract her for a half an hour, that was a half an hour out of her day.
And it's interesting that to distract the people with no communication skills, you don't even speak the same language.
And it was so unnecessary. We had another thing that was so interesting. With that Polaroid, I talked to Noah Wiley about this. When he was on the show, he had been in Macedonia. He had the same experience. After we took the picture of, I always call her my little girl, is what I really call her. So after we took a picture of her, we went out, and Barry thought, just do families. There were almost no adults. He just started saying families, and they materialized.
Because what people don't realize is that these people don't even have photos of anyone in their families, and they don't have mirrors, so they don't even know what they look like.
They've completely lost their history, and we have one more clip that'll show
you a little
bit. Yeah,
we're going to show that on the next...
Okay.
Okay, but Jeanette and her boyfriend went with a Polaroid camera that they got in Tirana, the city, that they were there, and they took Polaroids, and these people were so thankful to have some sort of record of their family that had survived and that was there.
Right. It's like a beginning for them to build history again.
Right.
And this was the most amazing experience. I'm going to volunteer again this summer. AmeriCares has a camp for kids with AIDS. That's something I never would have done. And from my experience if you haven't done stuff in your life, it gives you so much. And a great place to start is with the organization I went over there with, AmeriCares. I cannot speak highly enough about these people.
Well, I will tell you one thing about AmeriCares. For every $1 donated by you, $24 worth of relief goes out, because they are able to get corporate people to match the funds. For every $1 given, $24 goes out. They have been at every major world crisis since the inception. They were in Somalia. They're everywhere that there is war-torn or famine, and they help people, and it's a wonderful organization that is rated the highest in the philanthropy rating groups as far as how much money goes out. That's the number for AmeriCares. Jeanette, I thank you very much.
Thanks.
And you know, I love you. We'll be right back with your good man, Charlie Brown. Charlie Brown is nominated for 4 Tony Awards, including Best Revival of a Musical. In the song My Philosophy, Sally takes a new approach to a failing grade. Please welcome Tony Award nominee, and in my opinion, the one who's gonna win, Kristen Chenoweth and Stanley Wayne Mathis.
Oh, yeah? That's what you think. Oh, yeah? That's what you think. Yeah, that's what you think. Oh, yeah, that's what you think.
What?
That's my new philosophy. Oh, yeah, that's what you think.
Well, why are you telling me?
Hmm?
Why are you telling me?
Why are you telling me? I like it! That's a good philosophy. Why are you telling me? Why are you telling me? Why are you telling me? The teacher gave a D on last week's homework. She said, Miss Sally Brown, your grades are going down. I could have told her.
Your new philosophy.
My new philosophy. Miss B, I'm she. Look, C, a D, a D. Well, why are you telling me? And that's my new philosophy.
That's your new philosophy.
Why are you telling me? Philosophy.
That's great, Sally, but I've got to go practice Chopin's Nocturne in B flat minor.
No! I like it. No! That's a good philosophy. No! No! No!
That's your new philosophy, huh?
Yes! I mean, no! Just like a busy bee, each new philosophy can fly from tree to tree and keep me moving.
Philosophy.
My new philosophy.
Sally, some philosophies are simple. Man does not live by bread alone. Some philosophies are clear.
Leave your message at the sound of the tone.
Some philosophies pick and choose, deciding what goes in it. Some take a lifetime.
Mine take a minute.
But Sally, anything that takes only a minute can't be very lasting. For instance, Beethoven took over 2 years to complete his brilliant 9th symphony.
No!
I can't stand it!
I can't stand it! I like it! It's like a guarantee, my new philosophy, and things are sure to be a whole lot brighter. Oh yeah, that's what you think. Why are you telling me? No, I can't stand it. Now life is free and easy, much more philosophy's with my brand new. You know, someone has said that we should live each day as if it were the last day of our life.
Ah! This is the last day of my life! Help me! Help me! Ah!
Clearly, some philosophies aren't for all people. And that's my new philosophy! Yeah!
Drama Desk Award and the Outer Critics Circle. And this Sunday, you are going to be nominated for a Tony.
That's right.
How'd you feel when you found out?
I was eating Raisin Bran when they announced it on New York One, and the whole bowl fell to the floor.
Really?
I couldn't believe it.
Now, are you scared? Are you nervous?
I'm very nervous. I'm in great company that night, but really just to be nominated, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, it's a great party to be invited to, and I'm honored just to be there.
It was a lifelong dream to get a Tony Award?
Lifelong dream. I've watched it. As you have our whole lives,
right,
on TV, Emmys, Oscars, Tonys, and now I'm going to be there.
Yeah.
It's thrilling.
And aren't you doing this number right before the category?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, I'll be doing My New Philosophy, and the rest of the cast will join me at the very end. And then it's my category, so we'll see what happens.
And you're going to be wearing this?
I'll be wearing this.
Oh. Did you get another dress in case?
I did. Tommy Hilfiger, actually. provides my clothing, and it's beautiful. So hopefully I'll get a chance to change clothes.
Well, isn't there somebody who can quick change you?
Yeah, if I can get them backstage and work it out.
Right, you know Bobby Pierce? He used to quick change me on Broadway?
Yeah.
Quickest changer on Broadway.
Great.
I called him, and he said he will be there, and he will get you in your outfit.
Thank you.
He will. He'll strip you down, get you in your clothes.
Thank you.
Because you know what? When you're up there and you win, I think you should look in your own clothes because you're going to win if you ask me. Tell everyone how old you are just to make me feel a little worse. Tell everyone.
I'm late 20s.
Late? How vague. Late 20s. She's a young baby. Look at her. And she's going to be a huge, 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 huge star, not only on Broadway, movies and everything. You have a phenomenal cast there. At the show, You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, a phenomenal cast. It's at the Ambassador Theater, and playing Linus today, Schroeder today, was Stanley Wayne Mathis. Let's hear it for Stanley. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you haven't seen the show, you should go see it. I loved it. I saw it twice. Stockard Channing, up next. Don't go away. Our next guest is an immensely talented actress who has starred in such enjoyable films as Grease, Six Degrees of Separation, The First Wives Clubs. Recently, she's been nominated for a Tony Award for her role in The Lion in Winter. Please welcome back to the show, Stockard Channing. Stockard, and congratulations on the Tony nomination.
Thank you very much.
You've won a few, have you not?
I've won one.
You've won one? Yeah. Isn't that nice?
Yes, it's great.
It is. Where were you when you found out?
I was, it's funny, I really had no idea that they were being announced that day.
Right.
So I was in my kitchen, and there were these weird messages on my answering machine. It's close to her and said, oh, I knew it, it's wonderful, it's great. I said, he's lost his mind.
Right, right, right.
So I called on my friend John Guare, actually, who wrote Six Degrees, and he told me. And it wasn't that thing, you know, where you know, something's going to be announced, and you wait, and you wonder. And the phone doesn't ring. I had no idea. So it was like it was doubly great.
It was like a surprise gift.
I didn't have dread.
Right.
You know, we hate dread.
How do you feel to be back on Broadway? Has it changed a lot?
Well, it's interesting. You know, I've worked a lot at Lincoln Center, and to be back literally, physically in Broadway, on that area, it is amazing. The people.
Right.
And I have two dogs, and I will bring them to the theater, and I will try to walk dogs between shows on a Wednesday afternoon. I mean, the dogs are like terrified.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing. Because it's great that they've done all these renovations, but you know, since it's not as scuzzy as it used to be, you've got all these tourists and they're all looking up.
Yeah.
They're all looking up and bumping into each other.
Exactly.
And, you know,
look, there's the Lion in Winter.
And then suddenly look down and there's a dog. You
right,
know?
Right, right, right.
No, but it's great. There's a lot of life in that part of town now. It's wonderful.
A lot of life in the show that you do. You broke your arm during it.
No, I didn't break it, actually.
You didn't break it?
No, I didn't. It was very strange. I'm in the show with Lawrence Fishburne, and we play a rather dysfunctional married couple that happens to be in the 12th century. Right. So you got crowns, you've got robes, and then we just bash the crap out of each other and fight, and I have to, you know, beat up on him, and he doesn't beat up on me, but I have to fall down. And one day I woke up and my hand wouldn't move. Mm. It was like this, and it wouldn't do that. It would just do that, and it kept growing in the course of the day, and I was terrified.
Right.
So they sent me to a hospital for special surgery, and you know, and they said, you can't do this show tonight. This could be vascular damage. The word thrombosis was tossed around. Not a word you really, you know, want to hear.
Not a word I even understand, frankly.
Thrombosis, you know, vascular, and the hand wouldn't move, and I couldn't do the show that night. And I'm lying there at the MRI going, thinking I'm going to die,
you know?
Hand doesn't move. So they put me in a splint, you know, those custom splints, those all fiberglass.
Right.
They said, okay, tomorrow, why don't you try doing the show? Of course, I mean, I was like RoboCop. I mean, by the 12th century, I showed up, I had all the, like, changed the clothes, and there's a crown in my head and all this stuff, except I've got this thing.
Yeah,
this
you're like a bionic woman there.
Thing. So Lawrence took one look at me and said, oh, boy, you know. So we tried it once, but it was a little strange. So the next day, and this is absolutely true, I said, oh, I'm just in despair. How am I going to do this? And I go to see a Chinese herbalist who also does acupuncture. And the man turned out to be an orthopod, whatever, from Shanghai.
Right.
But he is an acupuncturist here. He said, oh, wow, will you allow me to look at that? And I said, well, sure. And 15 minutes after acupuncture and massage with liniment, it was like miraculous. It turned out it was soft tissue
damage. You know what? I had the same thing. I had a sciatica thing.
Yeah.
Went to every doctor and chiropractor.
Exactly.
Went to a Chinese herbalist guy, stuck a few needles in me, gave
exactly.
her a couple powders. Never had it again.
I know.
I totally
believe
in that.
I mean, I'm not putting, I believe it. They're wonderful, special, sort of divine. They're wonderful people, but it was fascinating. So I had, but that, you know how emotionally, how weird it is, you get so scared.
Yeah.
Because you're convinced, you know, that everything's over. But
yeah, we do need, you know, we do need the regular doctors,
yes, we do.
Too.
I don't, you know.
After you exhaust all of that opportunity, I went to this guy, and I'm telling you, it worked for me. Back with Stockard Chatting. Don't go away right after this. With the amazing Stockard Channing. My son is so thrilled. You are on his favorite show, Batman Beyond.
I had no idea.
Yes.
No, it's amazing. They said, would you do these little, it's kind of fun. You go in a studio and you do this thing very fast and you read these lines. And I had no idea it was such a big deal.
It's huge.
Uh-oh.
My son loves it. It's all he wants to be, Batman Beyond.
Uh-huh.
Not just the regular Batman.
No.
It's a whole different costume.
Second generation, I know.
Exactly.
And they said, oh, you have to see this. You're great in the last episode. So they showed me this tape, and I was appalled. I said, I don't look like that. Because I didn't realize the woman I'm playing, she's very old. She has all these glasses. Yeah. She has white hair. She's like this. And I said, wait a minute. We don't go through hell like this to look good for that.
Exactly.
So, you know,
well, anyway. Because it's 60 years later, and Barbara Gordon is now a grown
Barbara
woman.
Gordon.
There you go.
Barbara Gordon.
I know. I watch it every day. Trust me. You and I have the same after-theater ritual.
Yes.
Have to go to Joe Allen's.
That's right. That's right. Yep. You know, it's amazing. I love going there. And you see everybody that's around, everybody's in town. It's a great place.
It's a wonderful restaurant on Restaurant Row on 46th Street. After or before the theater, go there. And it's such a great spirit of the whole
and
what the theater's
changed.
About.
Since I first came to New York a long time ago. It hasn't changed.
It hasn't changed. I wish you all the luck in the world
Thank
on
you.
The Tony Awards
Thank
this
you.
Sunday night. You
he
are phenomenal.
You will be missed.
Well, I will be there in spirit.
Good.
It is a wonderful show. I saw it. It is brilliant. And you were fabulous in it. Stockard Channing, The Lion in Winter. We'll be back right after this.